In Abitibi, we forget that James Bay, which gave access to Hudson Bay, is only 350 kilometers from Rwanda. Hudson Bay, discovered by Henry Hudson more than 400 years ago, is truly a forgotten sea. It's true that Hudson Bay had a bad reputation, dangerous, icy, shoals that make navigation perilous. And in addition, Henry Hudson himself lost his life on his exploratory trip, victim of a mutiny. According to our research, the last sailing on the east coast of Hudson Bay dates back to the 1920s. July 23, 2017. With my two sons, this crazy project to go exploring James Bay and Hudson Bay with a sailboat to meet Inuit and Cree finally comes true. And here is the big departure. 14 kilometers on La Grande River to the mouth of James Bay. First mooring in the Kakasituk Island. Day 2, Kakasituk Island to Long Island, a 95 kilometers navigation. We are now leaving James Bay to enter Hudson Bay. And near Long Island, we have an unusual meeting, a tugboat carrying a barge. The crew is as surprised as we are to meet in the middle of nowhere. We will learn a little later that this barge was making the return trip of building materials between Waskaganish and Kujarapik. Long Island in the Nunavut territory. Day 3, Long Island to Blackwell Harbor mooring, a 95-kilometer route. The navigation is in a fairly rough sea, with vigorous crosswinds that propel us at relatively high speed of 11 to 14 km per hour. At 19:30, we arrive at Blackwell Harbor, which is actually a small bay protected from the high seas. Day 4, a short 26-kilometer navigation from Blackwell Harbor take us to Coojarabic. At the mouth of the Great Whale River, we see the freighter Sarah Degagné moored off the coast of Coojarabic. This cargo ship supply the community annually with food and merchandise of all kinds. Upon arrival, many canoes can be seen commuting to the traditional annual community camp on the south bank of the Great Whale River. We also take the opportunity to ask them for help to put back our jib halyard that had fallen at the Kakasituk Islands. Before leaving, members of the Creek community invited us to visit their traditional annual camp. The traditional camp of the Creek community takes place during 3 weeks in July to reconnect and transmit ancestral tradition. At around 6 p.m., we left Coojarabic in a light rain and traveled to Nelson Island in the Manitounuk Islands, a navigation of 21 kilometers. But slowly, a thick fog settles and our navigation is more complicated. With GPS, we finally managed to anchor in Lelièvre Bay in the Manitounuk Island around 8:45 p.m. from Ladbroke Island to Castle Island, a gentle navigation of 43 kilometers protected from the high seas. At low tide, we pick a big bowl of mussels. On the menu tonight, mussels with white wine. Castle Island is an island of great beauty, full of contrast. On the east side, conifers abound and reach an astonishing size for this latitude. On the west side, the vegetation swept by the cold winds of Hudson Bay becomes very sparse. Day 6, from Manitounkalun to the mouth of Goulet, a journey of 72 kilometers. The passage of boat opening is probably the most delicate part of our expedition. That allows us to leave the protected waters of Manitounk Sound to reach the open sea of Hudson Bay, a narrow, navigable passage of about 10 meters only, used by Cree and Inuit, but whose exact depth is not known. Finally, the boat opening went well, but we still recorded a minimum depth of only 5 foot. Here we are at the spectacular mouth of the Goulet. We arrive at the mouth of the Goulet around 7 p.m., exact time of the low tide. We knew that the tide current was maximum at this precise moment, but taking into account the time, we decided to try to go countercurrent to avoid a too late arrival. At 7:15 p.m., we entered the Goulet. After about 2 kilometers of navigation, it became impossible to go forward, even with the engine at full power. After several attempts, we decided to just stay in place and wait for the rise of the tide. It will finally be necessary to wait until 10:30 p.m. before succeeding to overcome the force of the current. The 22 kilometers separating us from our planned mooring site were therefore made at night, carefully following our planned GPS route. Our departure to Mauillac is at 5:30 a.m. to reach the Goulet at the exact moment of the low tide at 8 a.m. Passage in the Goulet was admirably done. We took advantage of the strength of the tidal current to propel our sailboat at high velocity. This descent, in which we reached a maximum speed of 22 km per hour, was made in total control. In the Nastapoca Strait, the northwest winds are increasing and larger waves makes our navigation quite uncomfortable. We decided to spend the night in the small sheltered anchorage of Mauillac community. Meanwhile, the weather forecast has completely changed. A windstorm was announced in the next 2 days, which was to last at least 4 days. In the morning of July 31st, our decision is now taken. We go back to the south. We really had no choice but to go back south if he wanted to meet the expected date of our return to work. It was with a little regret that we gave up to go to the beautiful Nastapoca Falls, only 40 kilometers further north. Upon arrival, we are seduced by the beauty of the site. We also receive greeting from an Inuit family whose camp is located on the sandy shore of the river. This is a family from the Mauillac community who practice traditional fishing and goose down harvesting activities. They occupy the site for a period of 2 weeks. During the night, the winds started to be felt. For 3 days and three nights, strong winds of more than 35 km per hour swept the region. Sheltered in our tiny cabin, we sleep, we eat, and we observe the belugas that are more and more present near our sailboat. Day 13. We announce a weakening of the winds during the day. Departure scheduled at 9:30. For an expected arrival at high tide in the boat opening around 6:30 p.m. Mooring in the center of Castle Island in the Manitounuk Island. 14, from Manitounkalun to Kujarabi. Small stop for a light lunch in town and to refill a 5 gallon of gasoline. And then we go back to our mooring site at Black Whale Harbor for an arrival around 9 p.m. We have an unexpected visitor. A young seal approaches our boat as he were looking for a little treat. Unluckily, we had nothing to give him on hand and he left. Day 15, a 104 kilometer sailing trip between Black Whale Harbor and Long Island. Little detour to Bear Island looking for a possible polar bear presence. Mooring along elongated islet sites of Long Island. Day 16, Long Island to Cape John, site of the former TDS 410 military base, a 26 kilometers navigation. This former radio station was in operation from 1958 to 1965. Its mission was to identify possible airstrike from the Soviet Air Force. In the late afternoon around 4:45 p.m., we return to the Kakasituk Islands for a late arrival at our mooring site at 11 p.m. We'll be right back. Day 17, last day of navigation. A first 52 kilometers navigation and an arrival at 4:45 p.m. at Strapnus Island, located at the mouth of the Lagrange River, waiting for the high tide at 7 p.m. to let us enter the Lagrange River. At around 7 p.m., we began our last 23 kilometers navigation to reach Chisasibi. Along the way, we crossed the former village of Fort George, where the actual inhabitants of Chichasibi used to live before they were relocated to Chichasibi in 1980. Our odyssey of nearly 1,100 kilometers on the sea is now over. We will keep an unforgettable memory of this wonderful adventure in the land of Cree and Inuit.